طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So last time we talked about the shift keying techniques which are used to modulate the or to convert the digital signal to analog signal before we transmit it over bandpass channel. This is part of broadband transmission. We talked about amplitude shift keying, and we characterized that it was simple. However, it's prone to noise, in which case we have motivated the use for frequency shift keying. For frequency shift keying, we use the frequency to generate the symbols, the different symbols for the input bit. We talked about binary frequency shift keying, and we talked about this MFSK, or the minimum frequency shift keying, where we use the voltage-controlled oscillator to generate a coherent FSK signal, where we don't have any discontinuation in the composite signal. So today we need to talk about the fact that if we were to represent 2 bits or 3 bits at a time using one symbol. So for ASK, we will use different maximum amplitude for the sine wave. We know that. For frequency, however, we use different frequency ranges. So one particular distinction for FSK, in the case that the we want to represent number of bits more than one, we know that if we want to represent 3 bits at a time, what's R? R is 3. So in that case, the number of levels or the number of distinct symbols are 8. Zapt. So in ASK, we will use different amplitude for the sine wave, in which case we don't change the frequency properties. But here, we use different frequency altogether, which means that each symbol will take a different range of frequency. And here we have L different, or yani in that case, 8 different symbols. So,
how different the frequency ranges are, like between one symbol and the other?
So in general, we have the frequency representation of the composite signal. It looks something like this. So this has a carrier frequency of 10 megahertz. Here it's mentioned 10 megahertz. So the frequency spectrum of the composite signal around 10 megahertz, we have 8 different symbols. So we have 4 symbols here, and we have 4 symbols here. And this assumes that the 2 delta F is minimum. We have no gaps, no guard bands between the symbols. So in fact, when we calculate the signal rate and the bandwidth, which, as we have discussed last time, the bandwidth for one symbol is 1 plus D times S, right? And we said that if we have 2 symbols, then we have to add 2 delta F. And we said that the minimum value for the 2 delta F is 1 plus D times S, right? So in this example, he has chosen 2 delta F arbitrary as 1 megahertz. In fact, the bit rate for the input digital signal is 3 megabits per second. So what is S? S is A, is N times 1 over R, which is 3 times 1 over 3, which is 1 eba. What? Mega A? Board. This is signal rate. 1 megabit. The unit here is 1 megabit. Okay. So this is the signal rate. What is the bandwidth? The bandwidth depends on the value of D. So the bandwidth for one symbol, assuming that D is 0, so the bandwidth for one symbol is 1 megahertz. What is the bandwidth of all the FSK? here is 8 megahertz. Okay? And that assumes the minimum value for 2 delta F. Because it happens that 2 delta F here is chosen to be 1 megahertz. I don't have to give you this value. In fact, if I tell you what is the minimum bandwidth, you should be able to figure out on your own. So, one distinct thing in FSK that you need to remember is that the total bandwidth for FSK equals to, there's 1 plus D times S, yes, plus, this is binary FSK. This is binary FSK. Okay? Here, as we said, we have 8 of them. Okay? So what is, there is 2 delta F here, we know that. What is this number about in general? Yeah, so let's try to figure out. So let's look at this frequency spectrum here. We have, bravo, so we have this part and this part are fixed. And between here and here, we have 2 delta F. Between here and here, we have 2 delta F, and so on, right? This is in general, because if 2 delta F is minimum, then we have no guard bands. But in general, these symbols are separated by 2 delta F. This is the general case, right? What is the number of 2 delta Fs that we have here? Yes, so it's the number of symbols minus 1. So here, it's L minus 1. So this is the bandwidth for whatever number of symbols that we have. So if I tell you, we need to represent 4 bits at a time, how many symbols do we have? 16. So this becomes 15. So 1 plus D times S plus 15 times E, 2 delta F. Regardless of the value of 2 delta F. So this is valid for any number of symbols. For the case of binary, FSK is still valid because L is 2. We have 2 symbols. L is 2, so it works. So this is the general value for. So unlike ASK, and as we will see later, even PSK, because we don't have 2 delta Fs because we don't use the frequency or different frequency for each symbol. So this is valid in particular for FSK. Okay? Tayyip. So that's how the frequency spectrum looks like. Around the 10 megahertz carrier frequency, we have 4 symbols here and 4 symbols here. And you can, of course, calculate the middle frequency for each symbol easily. Tayyip. So as we said, what is the motivation behind FSK? It's more prone to noise, yes, and that's why the FSK, it tends to be more noise resistant. However, what's the cost that we had to pay?
The distance.
Bandwidth is much more. Okay? So at least double, if not more, depending on the 2 delta F. So the question is, can we get the same gain to be more noise resistant, but without changing the bandwidth? That's what TSK tries to achieve. However, as we will see, there is no free lunch. There's always some cost that you have to pay. You have to learn this in life. Nothing comes for free, okay? So, PSK, what it does is that it doesn't play on the amplitude, it doesn't play on the frequency, it plays on the phase. So this is the simplest form of PSK, where we have binary PSK, where we have only 2 symbols. Here the difference in the symbols is the phase. The difference here is the phase. So we have sine and minus sine, as opposed to for OOK or on-off keying, we had a sine wave or zero. We play with the amplitude. Here the amplitude is the same, but we play with the phase. So we have sine wave and minus sine wave. which means that we did not change the frequency properties of the composite signals, huh? So the bandwidth becomes a 1 plus D times S. This, we did not play around with that. So there is a small catch here. This is similar to ASK, right? There is a small catch though. The signal here, how did you call this? The signal here is inherently non-coherent. Inherently, and we need this. We need this non-coherence because we rely on the phase to estimate whether this is zero or one. So we need this there, right? But what is the implication of this in the frequency domain? If we have very sharp edges like this?
Very high frequency.
Very high frequency. Right? So this tends to have higher frequency compared to AM for sure. So the values of D tends to be close to 1 in the case of PISK. This is the main difference. So that's a cost. The other cost is the complexity of the receiver is much higher. Because here we use a different hardware circuit altogether. We use something called phase-locked loops, and we don't have to go through the details of this. But the design of the receiver tends to be much more complicated in that case. But it's attractive in terms of bandwidth. So this achieves a good trade-off between being noise-resistant and at the same time, the bandwidth is less. Okay? So that's the advantage of PSK. Another piece of good news is that the implementation is much similar to ASK. The only difference is that here, in ASK, we used unipolar non-return to zero. And here, for binary PSK, because we want to use a sine and minus sine, right? So we want to make it positive or negative. So this is, in fact, polar non-return to zero. That's the only difference. So if we input this to an oscillator with variable with fixed frequency, then we get a sine and minus sine, and that's all we need. Okay? So the only difference is that we need to have this negative instead of zero, because if we multiply anything by zero, we get zero, and that's what we did for ASK. Here, we use the non-return to zero, polar non-return to zero, which means that we don't need to have an exact zero. We can have a minus, which means that we play with the phase, not the the amplitude. So,
Doctor, for the PSK and ASK, we're using the non-return to zero for, as the encoding, right? But didn't we
this
say...
This is like the transmitter, huh?
Yeah, but in...
what we're trying to achieve here is to convert the digital signal to analog before we transmit it.
But in circuits 1, didn't we say that there were issues with...
In circuits 1?
In networks 1. Sorry.
Okay.
In networks 1, didn't we say there were issues with the non-return to zero that would the clock...
This is if we want to transmit it over the transmission line as a digital signal. We don't want to do that here. This whole thing happens at the transmitter before we send it. Okay? What we will send eventually is not the non-return to zero. It is the composite signal, the modulated signal. There's a big difference. This modulated signal is a bandpass signal. It's not a baseband signal, okay?
The non-coherence in the composite signal, how does the receiver is going to look like at the receiver side?
No, actually, we will have to avoid it at the transmitter side. So we have to have a bandpass filter here to limit the bandwidth of the transmitted signal. So which means that here there will have to be some kind of approximation. We cannot send very high frequency components like this. We have to have some approximation.
It's going to get saturated.
Exactly. Yeah, la. We cannot do that. We cannot afford this to happen. So we have to have a limited bandwidth at the transmitter before we send it. So that's how we... It turns out that for quadrature phase shift keying, or when we have two bits at a time, we can play with the binary PSK. We can generate the implementation for QPSK as two BPSK. Okay? All we need to do is just to split the incoming bits, similar to what we have done, if you remember, for QASK, and then we said this will create some kind of non-coherent signal. Then we crossed it out and we said that we use the voltage-controlled oscillator for the case of, FSK. So we didn't want this to happen, so we use voltage-controlled oscillator to make the signal coherent, right? But here, the non-coherence is by design. We need to have this non-coherence.
So with more the levels, we have a very complicated circuit, right?
Of course. Yes, of course. That's the cost that you have to pay in order, because when you increase the number of levels, what do you gain?
You need the different representations for the...
Yeah, Mahoy, you need different representations. What is the advantage of this?
It's for the...
What is the advantage of increasing the number of levels or increasing the number of symbols?
Transmit data faster.
Which means... For the same bandwidth, you can send higher rates, right? And if you want to send the same rate, then you need lower bandwidth, right? Which means that using more number of levels, if you have the thickness of the pipe the same, you can squeeze more data by having more symbols, right? But if you want to send the same bit rate, then you can have a shorter pipe or a lower bandwidth, right? So we can represent the QPSK as 2 BPSK. This is the main difference. One of them will be shifted by 90 degrees. Shifted, 90 degree shift. Which means one of them will use sine and minus sine, and the other one will use cosine and minus cosine. That's the only difference. By combining the two, you get all the four different patterns. You get a phase shift of 45, 135, and then minus 135, and then minus 45 degrees, which constitute the 2 pi radian. Okay? So that's the implementation usually of QPSK. And as we said before, this kind of implementation causes the non-coherence or the discontinuation of the signal. But in that case, it's fine. We need the signal to be non-coherent. There's no problem. We can deal with it using bandpass filters later on to approximate it before we transmit it to limit the higher frequency components. But here, the non-coherence is by design. We need the non-coherence. Meji, any questions so far? Type. We will talk now about how we represent these different phases in a lot more visual way. So we'll talk about another representation which will make this much better visualized now. Before we get to that, we talk about this simple example where we need to calculate the bandwidth for QPSK. For QPSK, we know that R is A. R, not L. R. We know L is 4. صح. R is 8. 2. We need to represent 2 bits as 1 symbol. So the number of bit element divided by the number of signal element, which is 2 over 1. So R is 2, which means that S equals to N, and N here is 12 multiplied by 1 over R. This is a 1 over 2, يعني. So this is 6 mega A baud. This is signal rate, okay? So the bandwidth is A is 1 plus D times S. If D is 0, then we get the bandwidth equals to S. Right? Very simple. And it's 6 megahertz. Okay?
Why don't we multiply?
Pay attention to the difference in units, huh?
Why don't we multiply by C of, which is
what? C? لا, C ده قلنا ده في ال... في البيس باند ترانسميشن سي قلنا valid في البيس باند ترانسميشن is not valid for broadband calls لأنه قلنا سي is based on some probabilistic bit pattern, because we're sending the digital signal as is over the transmission line. Here we're not sending this digital signal as is khalas. Here we have to modulate it. Here we have to convert it to analog signal before we transmit it. But C is not valid. D is the main factor here, not C. When D is a filtering factor. Okay? طيب, so that's the... So we have learned the time domain representation of any signal, and we were able to get some properties in the time domain. But then we talked about the frequency domain representation of the signal, which, we, as we said before, the frequency representation gives us a much better view of some properties of the signal that we cannot get otherwise using the time domain representation of the signal. We can calculate the bandwidth. The bandwidth becomes more visual. We can learn lots of other properties about the signals which we cannot get from the time domain. So this is another third representation of the signal. We call this the constellation diagram. The constellation. The constellation here focuses on amplitude and phase properties of the signal. It doesn't focus on the frequency representation of the signal. Okay? In this constellation diagram, sometimes we call it IQ diagram. In this constellation of a diagram, we represent a sine wave, a signal with fixed frequency, yani, as one dot in this constellation diagram. So, for example, if we have a sine wave that looks like this, where the amplitude is A, and we have like a phase shift here, which is, let's say, pi over 6, okay? This sine wave is represented as one dot, such that this dot is far away from the origin by a distance of A, and this angle is pi over 6. Okay? So this vector, so this dot gives us a vector. A vector has amplitude and phase. Okay? Amplitude, which is the distance to the origin, and the angle represents the phase shift of the sine wave. That's it. So each sine wave is represented by a dot, which means that any symbol can be represented by a dot in the constellation diagram. So let's see how this diagram is going to help us to visualize more the amplitude and the phase properties of the composite signal or the modulated signal. So that's very important. So using this simple concept, we can represent ASK or PSK. We cannot use this to represent FSK in any means. Okay, so forget about FSK for now. So we can use it to represent amplitude shift keying and phase shift keying. So for example, ASK was about changing the amplitude, and we use binary ASK to represent one symbol has a value of 0 or amplitude of 0, and the other one has a value or amplitude of A. So one symbol is 0 and the other symbol is represented by sine wave, okay, with amplitude A and phase shift of 0. So that's why it's on the x-axis, because all the phases of the of ASK is 0. So any symbols in ASK would be expected to be in the x-axis. Okay? So the BPSK or binary phase shift keying, you have one symbol which is represented by a sine wave of amplitude A, and the other one is represented by a minus sign, which means here the phase shift is pi, okay, with amplitude of A. And then QPSK can easily be represented using, this is 45 degrees, 135, minus 135, minus 45. Okay? So using this constellation diagram, we have very neat representation of the symbols, whether in ASK or PSK. طيب. Again, what is that? What is this going to help us? So, in fact, we have been telling you that ASK is more prone to noise. So here we can explain visually why this is happening, why this phenomena is happening, especially for ASK. When we have a zero, we send the symbol here at the origin. When we have one, we send a symbol which looks like this. Of course, at the receiver side, we have to add the effect of noise. So the effect of noise will look like this. So around the symbol, you will have something like this. So this is what you will see at the receiver. You will never get an ideal representation. So the noise will add some effects, artifacts, and this is what you will see. And here you will see the same. And here you will see the same. And here you will see the same. So if you look at it on the spectrum analyzer, this is what you will see. Okay? So from here, you can really appreciate why we are saying that. Because it looks like a clustered representation. At the receiver, you get some clustered representations. So for ASK, it's very clear when the noise increases a little bit, these clusters, they get close to each other easily, and you'll start to have some overlap, which means that the probability of error gets high. Where for PSK, the clusters are very, very far apart. So, the clusters are very far apart, in which case, the noise effect will be less. Okay? For QPSK, we can start to talk about a trade-off, a nice trade-off here. So, by increasing the number of symbols, as we said before, what do we gain? We increase the bit rate or for the same bandwidth, or if we send the same bit rate, then we need lower bandwidth, which is good. However, from here, as you can see, there is a cost. The cost is the clusters, they tend to be close to each other, in which case you will have higher probability of error. So it's a trade-off. You increase the number of symbols, yes, you lower the bandwidth requirement, but higher probability of error. Okay? So here we can visualize it in a more neat way. Okay. Why stop at this point? So the question is, why stop at this point? We can mix that in the IQ diagram or the constellation diagram. We can mix amplitude and phase. Okay? And talk about what we call a quadrature amplitude modulation. Quadrature here refers to the phase. Amplitude refers to amplitude. So this is a mix between the phase and the amplitude. The quadrature amplitude modulation tries to design the symbols in such a way that in the constellation diagram, they are organized in an efficient way such that the distances between these symbols is very wide, so that the effect of the noise will be low. So clearly, this is a very, very bad design. And this is even worse. So this is nothing but two ASKs, but one of them is shifted. Why do we have to do that? Which means that all the symbols are organized in one quarter of the constellation diagram. So the distances between the symbols is not far enough. So the clusters, they tend to be closer to each other, and the effect of noise will be high. So that's a better representation. This is the practical and better representation for QAM. And it happens to coincide with the quadrature PSK, because this square can be represented using a circle as well. PSK tries to change the phase but with fixed amplitude, which means that PSK tends to have a shape of a circle on the constellation diagram all the time. Okay? ASK tends to be in the x-axis because you are changing the amplitude, you're not changing the phase. So if we want to have 16 QAM, okay, so we can mix the phase and the amplitude. Okay? So this is a good design for 16 QAM. And as you can see, the dots are organized in such a way that the distances between each two points is good, is distributed neatly in the diagram. If I tell you this is 16 PSK, then you have to organize all the symbols in a circle. And as you can imagine, if we organize all the circles, all the points in a circle, the distances will tend to be less, very close. If I tell you 16 ASK, then they have to be on the x-axis, and again the distance. So if you mix both, then you can organize it neatly and constitute the whole diagram, which makes the distances between each two points much further.
So the 16 QAM is like, is it more prone to noise?
No, 16 QAM, of course, is more prone to noise compared to? You have to tell me compared to what? It's prone to noise if you tell me compared to 16 PSK. I tell you, no, this is actually, in fact, much better in terms of noise resistance. 16 QAM is better than 16 PSK, right?
True.
But if you tell me compared to QPSK, no, of course, this one is more prone to noise. However, this one has better bandwidth requirement or lower bandwidth requirement because here we're using 16 symbols, okay, in which case, if you want to send the same bit rate, we need lower bandwidth. Or with the same bandwidth, you can send higher bit rate. Okay, so it's always a trade-off. It's always a trade-off. Okay? So this trade-off we can understand more visually using the constellation diagram. Okay? Any questions? Okay. طيب. So far, خد بالك محمد عشان it's gonna get more complicated. Because you have been confused بال C وال D, we're getting to another thing now. So again, we talk about the evolution. We started from sending digital signal as is over the transmission line, which is what we have called baseband transmission. Okay? In which case, the transmission line has a low-pass filter effect, which means it has properties in the zero frequency, okay, or low-frequency components, such as wired LANs. That's possible. There's no problem with that. Okay. However, if we want to send the bits, the digital bits, over a transmission medium which in physically has bandpass effect, such that ADSL or wireless or satellite or something like this, then we have to shift the digital signal in the frequency domain. Okay, so that the transmitted signal or the modulated signal has no zero frequency. Halt. Okay? In that case, we have to use a broadband transmission, and we talked about ASK or amplitude shift keying. Keying here refers to the fact that you convert the digital signal to analog before you transmit. Okay? طيب. Here, that we talk about the case where we don't want to send a digital signal أصلا. Now we want to send an analog signal. Okay? So in which case, we have a voice signal, for example, and we want to send it as is. Even the voice, we are dealing with it in the digital domain. Yes, in some systems, yes, that's true. But in some other systems like radio broadcast, like TV broadcast, okay, in, especially in old systems, like until today, AM and FM, they use an analog transmission. They are not using, they are not digital khalas. They don't digitize the signal. They take the voice signal, they broadcast it. Okay, they don't convert it to digital khalas. Imagine? And the old versions of TVs, they still use analog TV signal and they send it as is. Of course, now we have digital video broadcast, we have digital audio broadcast, we have all of these, but these are recent systems. And the good thing is that in the digital domain, you can always process the signal in a more efficient way. We know how to deal with digital bits. We know very well how to deal with that. In analog, you have limitations in terms of the amount of processing that you do. However, there are some systems which are designed originally for analog signals. So now, our input is not digital anymore. It's analog. And we need to convert analog to analog. I told you, what's the point? Yeah, I mean, convert analog to analog. The problem here is that for our voice signal, for example, our voice signal, as we said before, it has a bandwidth of 4 kilohertz. صح? Okay? And by the way, for digital signals, we've been characterizing the digital signal using bitrate. صح? Because it makes sense. Bitrate, signal rate, baud rate, things like that. In the analog signal, there is no such thing. There's no bit rate. There's no bits, aslan. Okay, it's analog. We don't characterize the analog signal by the bit rate or the signal rate. We characterize it but by one and only thing, the bandwidth. The bandwidth of the signal in the baseband. Okay? However, if we take this analog signal and transmit it in the baseband, what will happen? So imagine radio, they are transmitting the voice, okay? And all the channels are transmitting the voice over baseband. What will happen? Can we hear anything? You cannot hear anything because you are sending the same signal over the same bandwidth, over the same frequency range. So you will not be able to hear anything. And that's why when you listen to radio, what you do is that you have to tune to the channel that you want to hear. When you are tuning, what essentially happens is that you are controlling the center frequency. Okay, which is the center frequency of the bandpass filter, okay, so that you are filtering a specific frequency range. And that's why while you are tuning, you may in fact hear some distorted voice. And once you tune in to the exact middle frequency of the channel, you start to hear very nice quality voice. Huh? Okay, so that's what essentially happens. You are controlling the middle frequency of the bandpass filter until it coincides with the middle frequency of the channel, and that's when you hear good quality voice. Okay? But the broadcasted signal itself is analog signal, which is superimposed on an analog signal, as we will see now. Okay? So the reason behind sending an analog signal using broadband communication is to facilitate a multiple access of multiple signals that travels through the air. So the only degree of freedom that we have is to use different frequencies. Okay? But since the bandwidth of the channel, the bandwidth of the baseband signal itself is the same, so we have to shift it in the frequency domain before we transmit. So what the transmitter does is essentially to modulate the signal in the frequency domain by shifting the signal from the baseband to a broadband frequency range and then transmit it. So each broadcast station uses a specific frequency range. So the modulation depends on the frequency that you want to have, which is assigned to this particular broadcast channel, and you have to modulate the signal before transmission. So again, here, we will do all what we have done before, because the fundamental properties of the signal, the amplitude, the frequency, and the phase, they still apply even in the analog domain, صح? So these three fundamental properties, they still apply in the analog and the digital domain. What doesn't apply here is that there's no mention of bit rate, there's no mention of baud rate or signal rate. There's no such thing here. The only thing we can use is the bandwidth of the signal. That's it. So that's why here we have amplitude modulation. So we'll change the word keying because it refers to converting digital to analog. Here, converting analog to analog. So we call it modulation. Modulation here is to keep the signal as is in the baseband and just shift it in the frequency domain. That's what modulation means. So these are again the fundamental or three techniques that we will talk about. Amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, and phase modulation. So amplitude modulation or AM is exactly the same thing, but instead of having an input signal, we call it the modulating signal, as digital, we have it as analog signal. We multiply this by a fixed frequency sine wave. So the fixed frequency sine wave, what it does is that essentially it shifts the whole signal in the frequency domain to a specific carrier frequency. That's it. So that's what it does. Very easy. So we multiply this by a fixed sine wave generated by an oscillator. That's it. So what we will have is something like this. As you can see here, the envelope of that sine wave is similar to the input signal. Okay? But this composite signal, it cannot have any zero frequency components at all. Even if the original signal has zero frequency, this one will not have any zero frequency, in which case it's shifted in the frequency domain. Type, what is the bandwidth of the composite signal? The bandwidth of the input signal is B, and remember for analog signal, the definition of the bandwidth is always A, the difference between the highest frequency and the lowest frequency. So we'll go back to the fundamental definition of bandwidth, okay? Which in the case of voice, it's 4 kilohertz. 4 kilo minus 0, it's 4 kilohertz, right? So this is the bandwidth. So why what we essentially have done here is that we shifted the signal basically in the frequency domain. By doing this shift, the bandwidth of the composite signal has become a 2B. ليه بقى؟ يعني why? هو بقى نايكويست هو يعني اللي اكتشف الموضوع. What happens is that نايكويست قال لك يعني احنا for each. And again, I will explain the reason behind it. If you don't get it, it's fine. يعني بس I'm telling you what is the reason behind it. يعني هو قال نايكويست قال لك ايه ان هو السيجنال when we look at it in the baseband we always deal with the positive frequency side, but if you inherently look at it, it has actually some shadow frequency in the negative frequency. This shadow frequency you don't see it in the baseband, but when you shift it, the minus becomes positive. So each baseband signal has some kind of a shadow frequency spectrum there. It appears when you shift the frequency in the positive frequency domain. Okay? So that's why the B, when you shift it, it becomes 2B. Okay? Why? Because the negative frequency, it appears. If you don't do this, what essentially will happen is that you have a signal that looks like this, and you are dealing with it as a bandwidth of B, which means that you will design your filter at the receiver side like this. So, and then you will start to have multiple channels and they will overlap together and you will have very, very bad system. Because remember, you are not sending only one signal. There are, in the air, there are multiple signals. So essentially when you shift one signal in the frequency domain like this, and you calculate the bandwidth as 1B, the system will not work because these channels will overlap over each other. So you will not get any good communication at all. So you have to pay attention to this shadow frequency, okay, which is what Nyquist has done. So this is the Nyquist theory. Nyquist theory, but all that, if you do modulation, the minimum bandwidth for the modulated signal is double the bandwidth, the baseband bandwidth of the original signal. It's double, at least double. Okay? So that's AM. So the radio, so that's the bandwidth for AM. AM radio looks like this, and these are practical values, by the way. This is AM radio. It starts from 530 kilohertz to 1.7. You can verify that on the radio. It's easy. Okay? So the channels are organized next to each other like this, and this is 10 kilohertz. Where by this 10 kilohertz came from? Why 10?
Because of the shadow.
Because of the shadow. Because of the shadow what?
I don't know how to put it exactly.
Why is 10? The carrier frequency changes for each channel. This is the low FC. It changes for each channel.
Because it's transmitting voice, maybe?
Okay.
And
yeah, it is transmitting
four
voice.
Kilohertz,
4 kilohertz, bravo Alek. So 4 kilohertz, this is the bandwidth of the voice, right? So what is the bandwidth of the AM? It should be 8. Again, so where is 10 come from? This is what we call by a guard band. So the 10, so it's supposed to be 8, right? So 8 is the ideal bandwidth that we need. But there is no such thing called ideal. So even if you design the bandpass filter at the receiver side, it will look like this. So you need to have some guard band. You need to have some distances between the channels. So the 8 becomes 10. So we call this guard band. But the actual bandwidth that you need is 8, which is double the bandwidth of the voice, which is 4 kilohertz. So that's easy.
But if the carrier frequency is not, for instance, 5 kilohertz, it should be shifted from the receiver side.
The what? Why? Now, on the receiver side, you have to dial to the channel that you want. And by dialing, you are changing the carrier frequency of this bandpass filter. Once it coincides exactly with the middle frequency, you hear the best quality voice. But this bandpass filter is never ideal. So it has like damping effect like this. And that's why we cannot have exactly 8 kilohertz. We have to have some guard bands. Okay? So AM is good. I need to move this slide later. Well, here we are talking about the equation for FSK for FM before we actually talk about the concept of FM. Each time I remember to move this slide and I forget. So in any case, so FM talks about what? Talks about changing the frequency of the modulated signal depending on the amplitude of the input signal. So this is the concept behind frequency modulation or frequency shift keying. This is what we have done. Except that for FSK or binary FSK, we had two states. Here it's analog. So we need to change the frequency of the output signal or the composite signal depending on the amplitude. So depending on the amplitude, again, you have fixed carrier frequency. And then depending on the amplitude, you have to go high or low depending on the amplitude. So what is the bandwidth of the modulated signal? I don't know. It depends on the amplitude of the input signal. So that's why there is that beta. This beta depends on the difference between the highest amplitude and the lowest amplitude of the signal. And based on this range, you can calculate the bandwidth for the modulated signal. Okay? So luckily, beta is given, is arbitrarily chosen. I will give it to you. But practically, Beta is in the range of 4 to sometimes 20. Yani it's really, really high. So practically, beta could have higher values depending on the amplitude. I told you, what if the amplitude is infinity? Can we have infinity? We cannot. So essentially, the transmitter will have to do some clipping, some limits to the amplitude of the signal. It has to have a limit to the maximum value and the minimum value of the signal.
This is like the voltage to the operational.
Right, exactly. So the operational amplifier has to kind of limit that. Okay, so the typical values for beta is between 4 and 20. And don't mix this with D or with C. D and C, they range from 0 to 1. This one is much, much higher. Okay? Type, what is the composite signal look like? This is how it looks like. So you have a signal which changes its frequency based on the amplitude of the input signal. So as you can see, if you look at here, for example, here you see the signal has higher frequency, right? And here, because the amplitude is low, you tend to have low frequency. And again, we use voltage-controlled oscillator in that case, and the voltage-controlled oscillator creates no discontinuation, as you can see. So the signal is coherent signal. So it's neat, it doesn't have any discontinuation. And that's the bandwidth effect. So what is the point behind FM if the bandwidth is really high? So why do we need it? So definitely the bandwidth requirement is really high compared to AM. So why do we have FM?
It's better quality, right?
Better quality, right? So that's why yani even we tend to listen to FM radio much more often compared to AM radio, unless مثلا want to hear مثلا حط القرآن ولا حاجة في الأيام. Other than this, we tend to hear على طول we listen to FM radio. صح? Why? Because the voice quality is much better, right? Why? Because again, the noise effect on the frequency properties of the any signal is very low compared to the effect on the amplitude. واضح? So that's how we design FM. So FM radio ranges, these are typical values again. So FM does range from 88 megahertz to 108 megahertz. But in that case, see the bandwidth for each channel is 200 kilohertz. How many times compared to AM? 20 times, which means that beta is A. What is the value of beta here? 19, yes. 19. Beta here is 19.
It should be 19, it's already multiplied by 2. It's then multiplied by
2. Plus 2. Yeah, well, ten you can multiply by 2 barbu. Okay. Yeah, so here is 20 compared to AM. So beta here is 90. So you have to pay a really high cost if you want to have better quality. That's FM. So again, can we have some kind of a trade-off? Can we create a good quality with less bandwidth? This is what, again, phase modulation tries to achieve. So phase modulation tries to change not the amplitude, not the frequency, but the phase of the signal, okay? In such a way that the phase of the signal is proportional to the amplitude. There is a mathematical proof that if you want to achieve this phase modulation, you can generate the composite signal, okay, such that the frequency of the composite signal is proportional to the derivative of the amplitude of the input signal. The derivative. So the only difference between FM and PM at the transmitter side is this derivative. If you take the derivative of the signal and then feed it to a voltage-controlled oscillator, then essentially you can create the PM signal. Okay? From this, we can appreciate why the PM has lower bandwidth requirements compared to FM. Why? Because the FM generates frequencies directly proportional to the amplitude of the signal, right? But here we generate frequency of the signal proportional to the change. The derivative is a gradient of the signal, which is the changes of the amplitude, not the amplitude, the change of the amplitude. Wada? And as you can visualize, as you can see, the change of the amplitude is much smaller compared to the absolute values of the signal. So that's why the frequency ranges here is much lower. So even though you have 2 times 1 plus beta times B, but beta here tends to be much smaller compared to FM. Much smaller. So beta here is usually in the range of 1 to 3. As opposed to FM, which ranges from 4 to 20. Okay, again, these are rough values. These are not exact values. Again, in all cases, beta will be given. So any question so far? So that's PM. The only difference is that we have to throw this derivative in the implementation, and that will give us the magic.
What is it used so far?
That's a good question. That's a good question. Someone asked me this question last year, and I didn't know the exact answer. The question is, why don't we have PM radio? This is a very logical question.
You must use by the military.
I didn't know exact answer for this, but I actually looked it up, and it turns out that many people are asking this on the Quora. You know Quora?
Yeah.
Many people are asking the same question, really. And the only answer was the receiver design for PM tends to be very complicated because they have to use analog integrated circuits, which they call it analog phase lock loops. These phase lock loops, these are very complicated. And in practice, it makes the price of the receiver much higher. The price itself, this complexity, makes the price of the receiver much higher, which defeats the purpose of radio broadcast in general, because they need the radio receivers to be very low cost. So that's why it was not attractive to have standards for PM radio. This is the only answer that I was able to find. But it's a very logical question. So that's the difference between AM, FM, and PM. So this is again. So the same equation applies. In fact, we can sort of say the bandwidth is always for all modulation techniques. The bandwidth is 2 times 1 plus beta times B. For AM, what is the value of beta?
Zero.
For FM? So 4 to 220. For PM, it's 1 to 3. In all cases, it will be given. Don't worry about it. You don't have to memorize these ranges. You don't have to do anything. Beta is given in all times. You don't have to estimate it, you don't have to calculate anything. Beta will be good.
The peak behind beta is the bandwidth of the source signal.
The A?
The bandwidth of the source signal.
What is that? What is the question?
B behind beta.
B is the bandwidth of the input signal, yes. Because we said the only way we characterize the input signal, because it's not a digital signal. It's not the bit rate, it's not the signal rate, it's only the bandwidth. Okay? Any questions? So this chapter is divided into two parts. The first part talks about digital to analog. Okay? For digital to analog modulation, still broadband, still the channel has bandpass effect, but the input signal is originally digital signal. So we deal with bits, in which case we have talked about bit rates, we have talked about signal rates. In the second half, we talked about analog modulation, in which case the input signal is originally analog signal. And again, we talked about amplitude modulation, frequency modulation and phase modulation, and we characterize the input signal by the balance. Okay? Any questions?
Can we have combination of, like the key?
Yes, that's a good question, bro. There's no such thing. We cannot, I'm not aware of any technique that combines the amplitude with the phase in the case of analog signal. Any other questions? Okay, so that's